Good morning. I want to welcome you to worship on this Memorial Day weekend. We have so much to be thankful for. And on this holiday in our country, you know what we do. We remember those who have given their life in defense of our nation, and we remember their sacrifice and give thanks to God. We also remember those that we have lost in our families, and possibly in the last year you've had loss in your family. So we're mindful of that and want to encourage one another. It says in Titus 2:13 that we are waiting for our blessed hope, the appearing of the glory of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ. As the people of God, we have hope in the return of Jesus to earth, and we are encouraged by that. That's going to be the topic of the message this morning. Again, I'm glad that you're worshiping with us.
Good morning. So good to be together in worship this morning. Psalm 7:17 says, I give thanks according to his righteousness, and I will sing praise to the name of the Lord, the Most High. Let's join in singing, Blessed Be Your Name.
Blessed be your name.
In this world that we should fear, because God is for us. Amen.
We won't fear the
Good morning. Couple of prayer concerns this morning. The family of Hoss Kendall, he died yesterday. And also remember Mackenzie Compton, the hospice is coming in for her. Scripture reading this morning is Mark 13, 32, 33, and 37. But concerning that day or that hour, no one knows, not even the angels in heaven, nor the Son, but only the Father. Be on guard, keep awake, for you do not know when the time will come. And what I say to you, I say to all, stay awake. May God bless the reading of His word. Let's pray. Lord, we just thank you for this beautiful Lord's Day that we can come together to worship. Lord, remember those prayer concerns because you know their needs. Just be with the families. Lord, guide Robert as he comes to bring the message. Lord, as we gather this morning to worship, just help us to remember the price that Jesus Christ paid at Calvary for our salvation. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Please be seated. I'm so thankful that I have the blessed assurance that Jesus is mine. And if you haven't made that choice today, I hope that you'll make that choice before you leave. Let's join in singing, Blessed Assurance, Jesus is mine.
Blessed Assurance.
Says in Psalm 6:1, is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. God is always there for us. Promises are true, always. Please stand as we sing, Always.
Seated, please. Psalm 121, verse 1 and 2. I will lift up my eyes to the hills. From where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, who made heaven and earth. The God that we love, that we serve, that we worship, is an awesome, mighty, powerful God. He's also a God who cares for us individually. And there is nothing that you or I face that escapes His notice. He cares about us. And that's what we've been doing this morning, is worshiping the one who is worthy of our praise and adoration. Join me in prayer, please. Father, thank you for your presence in our lives. There's never been a moment that we have lived without you being near to us. For those of us who are your children by faith in your Son, the moment we were saved, you put your Holy Spirit to live inside of us. So now not only are you with us, but you live in us to comfort and guide us, to help us. Thank you, oh God, for your promises. As we study your word this morning, I pray for understanding, for clarity. And I pray, Father, that we would act on what you show us from your word. Thank you for the hope we have in Jesus Christ and the promise of his soon return. I pray in Jesus' name, amen. Well, we have entered a new day in the church. I really do believe that there are some things that will not be going back to whatever normal used to be. And so we've been hearing people talk about the new normal all around us. There's a new normal when you eat out now in a restaurant, if that's something that you do. You'll notice that the first time you go to sit down again after restaurants are opening. There's probably already things that have changed at your business or will change when you go back. There are changes, but there are changes in the church. And so we can get discouraged, or we can look for opportunities to serve God. I read a survey this week I want to share with you. In the past 4 weeks, those who were actively attending church prior to church buildings being closed in mid-March and just recently reopening for many of us on Mother's Day, this survey said, in the past 4 weeks, those of you who were attending church regularly, what have you been doing? 40% said that they regularly streamed their own church service while they were unable to attend. 23% said they streamed a different church service. Now, this is for those overachievers. So they would watch their home church, and then they would watch somebody else's church service. So my mother and my sisters watch our church service, and then they watch other services as well. Sandy's mother watches our service, her daughter's church. She goes to her church, which is a drive-in church. The preacher preaches outside in the parking lot. And yesterday, speaking to our son, found out when their church is streamed, she's going to start watching their service. So some are just overachievers. So those that are watching this morning or live streaming or who will be watching, we're grateful that you have taken the time to worship with us. Those of you who are here this morning, I'm glad that it's not empty pews anymore. Maybe some empty heads in empty pews, but it's not empty pews. Just joking you. But notice this graphic at the bottom. 48% of those who had regularly been attending church said that in the last 4 weeks, not only have I not gone to church, haven't been able to, I haven't streamed. Now, that's the opportunity. You know, the good thing is that we've had people watching our stream services who had not been attending, who are not able to attend. And that is great. That is a blessing. But we see the opportunity that there are those who were coming regularly who have now disengaged from regularly being connected. And so just the challenge for us to stay connected, even if you're not able to get in person, right? Stay connected with other believers. Stay engaged in God's Word. Stay connected in a study of the Word of God. And we're offering those opportunities for you. I'm just pointing out that it is a different day. And I believe God will help us to rise to the challenge, to continue to reach people with the good news of Jesus Christ. We are going to be in 1 Thessalonians this morning and in the coming weeks. Our new series is preparing to meet Jesus this morning, but it's about the return of Christ. I shared with you recently that there are only two ways off the planet. Either you're going to die and meet Jesus, or he's going to come, you're still living, and you're going to meet Jesus. There's only two ways off the planet. So this series from the book of Thessalonians has to do with the hope of Christians in the imminent return of the Lord Jesus Christ. The church that was planted in the city of Thessalonica, that story is found in the gospel, in the book of Acts. And Luke tells us the story how in Acts chapter 16, the Apostle Paul had a plan where he was going to go, but God spoke to him in a vision, and a man from Macedonia said, "Come over here and help us." So where Paul thought he was going, he redirected, and then he went to the city of Philippi, where he led Lydia and her household to Christ and established the church in the city of Philippi. They were falsely accused, arrested, beaten, and put in prison. And then in Acts chapter 16, we have that marvelous story of God delivering Paul and Silas from jail with that earthquake, and how, as a result of that miracle, Paul led the Philippian jailer to faith in Christ. Not only him, but his entire household. What you see in the book of Acts is this pattern, that when the head of the house, usually the husband, when he is saved, it was just natural for others in his family to follow that lead and put their faith in Jesus Christ. Oh, may we see God do the same thing today. Not just one individual coming to Christ, amen, but an entire household hearing the good news and putting faith in Jesus. Well, after leaving the city of Philippi, Paul left and he went to the important city of Thessalonica. They bypassed Amphipolis and Apollonia, not because they didn't have a burden for the people that lived there, but because of Paul's practice to go to a larger city, preach the gospel, establish a work there, and allow those who were newly saved to take the gospel to those surrounding communities that were much smaller. So if you would stand, please, I want to read from Acts chapter 17, verses 1 through 4. You'll hear how the church started in that city. Now, when they had passed through Amphipolis and Apollonia, they came to Thessalonica, where there was a synagogue of the Jews. And Paul went in, as was his custom, and on three Sabbath days he reasoned with them from the Scriptures, explaining and proving that it was necessary for the Christ to suffer and to rise from the dead, and saying, "This Jesus, whom I proclaim to you, is the Christ." And some of them were persuaded and joined Paul and Silas, as did a great many of devout Greeks and not a few of the leading women. This is the word of God. Amen? Would you be seated, please? Well, we can learn a lot from Paul's approach to evangelism. Paul used the word of God to exalt and lift up the Son of God, and then the Spirit of God drew people to salvation. Whenever Paul talked to a Jewish audience, he used the Jewish scriptures, which is our Old Testament, to show how Jesus fulfilled the prophecies and promises of the Messiah and came to redeem us. Whenever Paul preached to Gentiles who had no framework of the Jewish scriptures, Paul would always begin with the God of creation and then declare Christ. Wherever Paul started, he met people where they were, but Paul quickly got to Christ. I like that idea that wherever you start, make a beeline to the cross. Always tell people what Jesus wants to do for them. Well, Paul stayed 3 weeks in the city of Thessalonica until some Jews in that city got riled up and caused trouble, so that they left Thessalonica and went on to another city. If you remember from the book of Acts, they went to Berea, where they were more noble-minded and searched the scriptures to see if what Paul taught them was true. But think about this. Paul spent just 3 weeks in the city of Thessalonica. People heard, believed, were saved, and then were gathered together to form a church. Just 3 weeks is all it took God to start a church in a city where there had been no gospel witness before. We often underestimate what God can do when we let Him. It is the work and power of God. Well, this theme that Paul adopted when he wrote back to this group of Christians was the theme of the return of Christ. these Christians that he had met just those three brief weeks, these Christians were ready for Jesus to come back whenever he returned, or they were ready to meet Jesus. Now you see, that whole generation and generation after generation has lived and died without the return of Christ. But every one of them who lived with the hope of meeting Jesus, every one of them met Jesus. Not at his return, but in their death. My question for us is, are we ready to meet Jesus? Christ is returning. And in each of the five chapters of this brief letter that Paul wrote back to these Christians, he mentioned the return of Christ. Let me show that to you. In chapter 1, verse 10, he said that we wait for his Son from heaven. Chapter 2, verse 19, before our Lord Jesus at his coming. Chapter 3, verse 13, to wait for his Son from heaven. Chapter 4, 16, for the Lord himself will descend from heaven. Chapter 5, verse 23, to wait for his Son from heaven. Did you notice chapter 1, 3? And chapter 5 have the same phrase, that we should wait for his Son from heaven. Now, 1 Thessalonians chapter 1, would you turn there in your copy of God's Word? Let me read what Paul had to say to these Christians. Paul, Silvanus, who's also Silas, and Timothy, to the church of the Thessalonians in God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. What did he say to them? Grace to you and peace. We give thanks to God always for all of you, constantly mentioning you in our prayers, remembering before our God and Father your work of faith, your labor of love, and the steadfastness of hope in our Lord Jesus Christ. When Paul thought about these Christians who he had only seen face to face in person for those few weeks, Paul thought about their consistency of faith. Notice this, that Paul addresses the believers at Thessalonica as a body, not as individual Christians, although he knew individuals, but as a body of Christians. The expression, grace to you and peace, though similar to the way that Paul introduced his other letters, Paul wrote 13 of our 27 New Testament books, Paul mentions grace and peace. Now, what is grace? It is the unearned, unmerited favor of God. You did nothing for God to show his grace to you, right? You can't earn it. That's what grace is. And then he mentions faith, peace. He mentions peace. He's going to get to faith, getting ahead of myself. But he mentions grace and peace. Peace is that relationship that we now have with God. We were once enemies of God, but we have been brought near to God by the death of his Son, the blood of Christ, because of the cross. So Paul uses these two words, and he offers it as really a blessing to these Christians. He says, may God give you his grace. May God continue to give you his peace. But it's, Paul said, I thank God every time I think about you. I pray for you, and I give thanks to God. I understand a little about what Paul was saying, because the same is true for each one of you. You know those weeks when we were unable to meet in person? And we talked either by phone or you would message or we would message back and forth. Prayed for you. And like Paul, I understood what it means not to be in person, but to long to be back in person again. And then to pray, thanking God for those brothers and sisters in the Lord. Like I thank God for each of you. Certainly is good that building is open and we're able to come back and. But Paul mentioned their faith, their love, and their hope. You know, this is called the triad of Christian virtues. And we're familiar with that, right? Paul wrote to the Corinthian Christians, and he said, these three remain, faith, hope, and love. Now, what is the greatest of those three? What did Paul say the greatest is? Love. The greatest is love, but they're all important, right? And so here he mentions all three of them to the Thessalonians. And he said, this is something that I think about when I think about you. I think about your work of faith, your labor of love, and your patience of hope. When he thought about them and their faith, he realized that they had true faith in God. This was evidenced by their repentance. They turned away from idols. We're going to get to that in verse 10. But they turned away from idols to the one true God. That's in verse 9, actually. And Paul noticed that their faith was vibrant and it was alive. I can say that about you as well. that through this difficult time that we've experienced, that instead of your faith diminishing, have you noticed your faith? I hope you've noticed your faith getting even stronger. Anybody say that? Well, that's what Paul's writing back to these Christians and saying, I thank God for your work of faith. And then he says, I thank God for your labor of love. The Thessalonians' love for Christ resulted in them serving God in the midst of persecution. See, the book of Acts tells us that those Jews who had got upset in Philippi and those Jews that got upset in Thessalonica, seemed like everywhere Paul went, trouble got stirred up because God was doing a work, that when Paul left, trouble didn't leave. So those new Christians, brand new in faith, suffered persecution immediately from those who didn't like the gospel being proclaimed in their city. But despite suffering, they immediately got to work serving God. I want to encourage you. I know things are kind of unusual right now, but every day look for ways to serve God. Don't sit down, sit back, and wait for Jesus to come back. Get busy and serve the Lord. And then the third thing Paul talked about was their steadfastness of hope or their patience of hope. The believers at Thessalonica fixed their hope solidly on the return of Jesus Christ. Now notice that each of these three virtues has Christ as the object. They had faith in Christ. They had the love of Christ. And they had the hope of Christ. I wonder about your life. Does everything in your life as a Christian, does everything point to Jesus Christ? You know it ought to. When you drift off to sleep at night, what are some of the final thoughts that you have? I know what it's like to be lingering there between sleep and being awake and have those gnawing concerns and anxieties kind of nipping at you. But I also know what it's like to doze off thinking about the promises of God. There's quite a difference between the two, aren't there? Isn't there? How about in the morning? What's one of the first thing that you think about in the morning? Wouldn't it be great as the people of God if one of the first waking thoughts we had every morning is this: is today the day that Jesus comes back? Because if it is the day he comes back, I want to be ready. And that's what Paul was saying as he wrote back to these Christians. You have consistent faith. I saw it in you when I was with you. I hear about it now. And I thank God that you are prepared whenever Jesus comes. And you're prepared to meet him. Look at verses 4 through 6. Paul goes on to say, "For we know, brothers, loved by God, that he has chosen you, because our gospel came to you not only in word, but also in power and in the Holy Spirit and with full conviction. You know what kind of men we proved to be among you for your sake. And you became imitators of us and of the Lord, for you received the word in much affliction with the joy of the Holy Spirit." Paul mentions again the persecution that they suffered immediately after getting saved. Well, Paul said that they were consistent in faith. But he said something else about them. He said that they were certain of their salvation. That's found in verse 4, this idea that God had chosen them, that God loved them. Now, 19 times in the book of Thessalonians, Paul called these Christians brothers. He was talking about our relationship as the family of God, brothers and sisters in Christ. And that word brothers, often translated brethren, includes men and women. And this idea that we are the family of God, 19 times in these five chapters. And in the second letter he wrote, those three brief chapters, 9 times he referred to them as brothers. The faith that the Thessalonian Christians had in God, it was firm. It was rock solid. And I wonder if that's the kind of faith you have in God. I mean, come on. These have been unusual, difficult times. There's so much uncertainty. Even today, where are we headed? What's going to happen? When are things ever going to return to something of normal? You know, in all of this uncertainty, there are things that are sure. And Paul names one of them here. And that's our salvation. Paul says, God loves you. Oh, he loves us, every one of us. And there may be things that I've wondered about in these recent months, but I can tell you something I've never doubted. is God's love for each one of us. His love is sure. Now I realize you're sitting in church, and the question I'm going to ask you, I know what you're going to do. You're going to answer the way I hope that you will answer, but I want you to think about your response before you shoot your hand up. I'm going to ask you a question. The answer is obvious, but is it really rooted deep inside of you that you believe this? The question is this: do you really believe that God loves you? Okay, I'm going to ask you now. Do you really believe it? If you do, indicate. All right, now, it's a good thing to tell the truth when you're in church, you know, in the building. But tell you what, it's a good thing to tell the truth wherever you are. Amen? So, God does love us. Now, the reason I emphasize this is that sometimes we act as though we question God's love for us. Maybe something difficult, painful, confusing happens to us. And we'll say something like, what was God thinking? Why would God let this happen to me? And sometimes in our pondering, in our questioning, what seems to be running underneath it is this current of distrust that God really has our best interest at heart. Well, let me remind you, he does. And Paul told these Christians, you knew when you heard the gospel that God loved you. And when you heard it, you grabbed hold of that truth because, you know, some of these Thessalonian Christians had never heard that idea before. Now, likely you grew up knowing that God loves you. Can you imagine never hearing that truth in your life until you heard the gospel of Jesus? And when they heard it, it changed everything about their outlook. God loves you. But Paul said something else to them. The reason they were so certain of their salvation. He said, God has chosen you. This is the Bible teaching that we call election. That God chooses who will believe in his Son. Now, the Bible teaches both the sovereignty of God, that God is in charge, that he calls whomever he will to believe. And the Bible also teaches the freedom of will, that we choose to follow after Jesus when he prompts us, convicts us. You see, the Bible teaches both the sovereignty of God, he chooses whom he will, and the freedom of man to follow after. You cannot ignore either teaching, and the further you get apart, the danger, the risk of going into error. We must hold both of these teachings because they're both in the Scripture. Paul referred to this doctrine of election. God chose you in Christ to believe. It's a marvelous thing. What does that mean for you? If you are a follower of Jesus Christ, then God chose you to believe in his Son. Aren't you grateful? 7 billion people in the world, over half of whom do not believe in Christ, do not follow Christ. Many have not heard his name, but you have not only heard his name, you have put your faith in him and you follow him. Are you not grateful that God has chosen you? Amen? And Paul said, you don't have to worry then, because those he chooses, he holds on to. He said the same thing to the Ephesian Christians, Ephesians chapter 1, verses 3 and 4. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in Christ with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places, even as he chose us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and blameless before him. He goes on to say, in love, he predestined us. It is this idea of selection. God chose us to believe. Now, the Bible teaches this. Whosoever will may come. Thank you. Whoever calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. Romans 10:13. But it also says, Jesus said, you didn't choose me, I chose you. Do you hear the tension in both of those? But both are true. And if you follow Christ, thank God for the work of his Holy Spirit, which is the third thing that Paul said to these Christians. Not only did they have consistent faith, not only were they certain of their salvation, but they had the conviction of the Holy Spirit. This is in verses 5 and 6. How do you know you are prepared to meet Jesus, whether in death or when he comes? It's if you have a consistent faith. there's faith, hope, and love in your life. And it's not just something you talk about, it's actually there. It's when you're certain that you belong to Him. You have no question, no doubts, because God's chosen you. And then Paul says it's because of the conviction. When you do something wrong, or you say something, or you think something, immediately the Spirit of God who resides in you convicts you of that sin that you've just done. Now, the question isn't just, do you regularly sense conviction in your life? It's, what do you do when convicted? You see, sometimes, as the people of God, we know exactly what we're doing is wrong. We're convicted in that moment before we sin. But sometimes, some of us, we just move right ahead, don't we? Ignoring the prompting, ignoring the conviction of the Spirit of God. What Paul is saying here is that God's Word transforms life through the work of the Holy Spirit. Now, if we would go back to Acts chapter 17, verses 2 and 3, you would see the words that Luke used to describe Paul's preaching. He said that Paul reasoned with the Thessalonians. He used a system of questions and answers to hear where they were, what they wondered, and then he would answer. He would explain, that is, he would read an Old Testament scripture, and then he would give understanding of how that fit in the salvation history of God. It said that he would allege, that is, he laid side by side the truth of Scripture and applied it to their lives. And all of this was Paul's proclamation of Jesus Christ. I've said it many times before, but when you come to church, when you worship, you don't want to hear my opinion. You want to hear the Word of God, don't you? Because my opinion's not going to help your life. My opinion's not going to change your life. But I tell you this, the Word of God applied by the Spirit of God will transform your life and my life. And that's what God did those three brief weeks. He established the church through the work of the Spirit of God. In John chapter 16, verses 8 through 11, Jesus described the work of the Holy Spirit. Now, this was in the upper room discourse, shortly before Jesus left the upper room, went into the Garden of Gethsemane to pray, eventually was arrested. The next day, he was crucified for our sins. So in that discourse, in 14, 15, 16, Jesus taught. He taught about the Holy Spirit in chapter 14 and 16. This is what he said about the Holy Spirit. When the Holy Spirit comes, he will convict the world concerning sin and righteousness and judgment. Concerning sin, because they do not believe in me. Concerning righteousness, because I go to the Father and you will see me no longer. Concerning judgment, because the ruler of this world is judged. The conviction of the Holy Spirit is what makes the difference between someone who hears and ignores, and someone who hears and believes the Word of God. And if you have heard and believed the Word of God, maybe you've not understood what was happening, but what was taking place is that the Spirit of God brought conviction, and you responded to the work of the Spirit of God. That's where Paul talked about the power of the Holy Spirit to change your life. He talked about the conviction of the Holy Spirit to show you what was right, what was wrong. And then Paul mentions the joy of the Holy Spirit. So, Paul wrote back to these people and he said, you're not worried. You are prepared to meet Jesus. Paul said, the reason I can say this about you is because you have a consistency in your faith. There's faith, hope, and love in your life. There is a certainty about your salvation. You know God chose you. You know God loves you. Paul said, there's something else I notice in you. It is the conviction of the Holy Spirit. When God convicts you, when God prompts you, you act and reply and respond. You see, you are not a child of God unless the Spirit of God convicted you of your sin and you turned away from your sin and turned to Jesus. You know how I know that? Because unless you repent of sins, you cannot be born again. It is only a sinner that needs a Savior. If you don't know that you're a sinner, then you don't need a Savior. You're okay just the way you are. Now, the truth is, you're not okay just the way you are. You think you're okay. But when you come to realize how you have broken the holy standard of God, which is not just a bunch of rules that God threw out to spoil your fun, they are rooted in His character of holiness. And when you understand that you have not simply broken the law of God, but you have broken the heart of God, and you can do nothing to bridge the gap between you and God, and you fall on the grace and mercy of God and turn from your sin, you are ready to be saved. You know, there is a gospel that is not the gospel declared by the New Testament. There is a gospel being declared today that says, come follow Jesus. Come follow Jesus. Oh, just love Jesus, with no mention of repentance. And you cannot be born again unless you turn from that which has separated you from God to begin with. Repent. The kingdom of heaven is at hand. That was the message that Jesus proclaimed. So Paul pointed to the proof of the election of these Christians. He says, how do I know you're saved? Paul says, because the Holy Spirit convicted you. And you responded to the gospel, and you experienced the joy of the Holy Spirit. So Christian, can I ask you this question? Are you prepared to meet Jesus? I mean, are you really ready to meet Him, either in death or at His coming? Are you ready to meet Him? Well, you are if there is a consistency in your faith. That is, if you can look in your life and see faith, hope, and love alive and well in you. Do you have certainty of your salvation? You know God loves you, and you know He chose you in His Son. And do you have the conviction of the Holy Spirit? Can you point out every day how the Spirit of God who lives in you, if you're a Christian, how the Spirit of God is constantly pointing out, prompting, convicting you of sin, righteousness, and judgment? You see, that's the work of the precious Spirit of God. And then there's a fourth thing. Do you have a convincing witness for Jesus Christ? Paul said, in these verses, 7 through 10, so you became an example to all the believers in Macedonia and in Achaia. These were two regions. Not only has the word of the Lord sounded forth from you in Macedonia and Achaia, but your faith in God has gone forth everywhere, so that we need not say anything. For they themselves report concerning us the kind of reception we had among you, how you turned to God from idols to serve the living and true God, and to wait for His Son from heaven, whom He raised from the dead, Jesus, who delivers us from the wrath to come. Oh, there's so much there that ought to encourage us. But Paul says, the reason I know you're prepared to meet Jesus is because of your witness. There is no doubt that you are following Jesus Christ. Now, they had become an example, Paul said, to the whole province of Macedonia. Now, this is really interesting because Paul said, you became an example. The word you is plural. He's talking about all the Christians in the church at Thessalonica. And he said, not you became examples. He said, you became an example. Once again, he's not talking about individuals. He's talking about the impact of this body of Christians on their community. So when Paul thought about them, yes, he knew individuals, like in the book of Romans, he named this person and this person and this person. But when Paul thought about the Thessalonians, he thought about them as a body, as a unit, as a family. And he said, as a family, you have made an impact on your community. I wonder, could that be said about us, members of First Baptist Church? You see, what Paul is pointing out, how when one falters, you help them up so that when you're strong, you're able to help another brother or sister who's weak in that moment. But watch out, because eventually when you go through that period of time and you need to be lifted up and encouraged, that's okay, because they'll be there for you. You know what we say? I got your back. Well, that's what Paul's saying, that you became an example. Paul said, you're prepared to meet Jesus because you're living for Jesus. I don't know if you're hearing my heart, but that's what I want God to say about us. That we're ready to meet Jesus because we, not one or two or three, not this person or that person, but that we are an example to those around us. You see, Thessalonica was a thriving city. It actually is a modern city today. It's inhabited today. It's one of those biblical cities that is still populated today. And in that day, Thessalonica was a port city, a prominent city. So you had people that came from all over to Thessalonica to bring goods. They were there for a time and then they left. This is what was happening. People would come into Thessalonica and they would hear and get a witness from a Christian. And they would, whether they would believe or not, they would then go someplace else. And what Paul said is that the witness of the church was being sounded forth all over in that province. Oh, may God do the same in our lives today. That wherever we go or whoever interacts with us, whether it's in our community or in your workplace, that people will have a witness from Jesus Christ and that God will be glorified. The final thing, the reason Paul said to these Christians, I know you're prepared to meet Jesus, is that they had a changed life. This is in verses 9 and 10. Remember, he said in verse 9 that they turned from idols. I don't know if you know anything about idols, but they're not real. And it's sad that there are a lot of people in the world who actually worship a figure, a figurine, offer sacrifices to that idol, thinking in some way they must appease or satisfy that deity in order to get some kind of help. There are so many in the world who worship idols. And these Thessalonians were like that. They had lived their life worshiping false gods, but when they heard the gospel of Jesus Christ, they turned away from those false idols to serve the true and living God. And God did a great work in them, and God does the same thing today. You know, they didn't add Jesus to their list of idols and say, oh, we'll just follow you, Jesus, and all the others. They cleared every other god and put the one true God in the center of their life. What about you? Listen, you don't have to have a little figurine to worship an idol. We can worship money and success or status or power, prestige or pleasure, entertainment. There are a lot of idols today in America. And there are those who profess to follow Jesus who are actually worshiping other things besides Jesus. Paul said, no. When I think about you Thessalonians, this is what I think about. I think about the way God changed your life. The way he turned your life literally upside down, reoriented you, and you are not the same. What about you? Can you say that? Since you started following Jesus, are you different? Are you changed? I know I am. I know I have values today that I did not have before I got saved. I know I am growing in my faith, and I want to grow in my faith. My life has been changed by Jesus Christ. And Paul said this to these Christians. Now that he's changed you, you live every day expectantly anticipating and faithfully serving Jesus. You can't wait until you see him face to face. Now, I understand this. You're liable to say, but preacher, they lived their whole lives. They died without the return of Christ. So what good did that do them? Oh, it did them a whole lot of good. Because when they met Jesus in death, they were ready. You know how I know? Because they lived every day as though this might be the day that I see Jesus face to face. And I'm telling you, it changes everything. It changes your priorities. It changes your anxiety level because you realize if it's not today, it may be tomorrow. If it's not tomorrow, maybe the day after that. But whenever it is, today, I'm going to serve Jesus. I'm going to love Jesus. It makes all the difference in our lives. Look at this changed life. I want to compare verse 3 with verses 9 and 10. Remember in verse 3, he talked about their work of faith, their labor of love, their patience or steadfastness of hope. Well, look how this brought fruition in their life. Their work of faith was actually seen in the fact they turned from idols to a living God. Their labor of love was experienced in their service to the true and living God. And their patience of hope was seen in the fact that they waited for God's Son from heaven. They just looked up. I can just see this. Just occasionally throughout the day, looking toward the eastern sky. And by the way, why to the east? Because he's coming back. It says he will come from the east. And by the way, I don't know if you realize this, that when we bury a body in a cemetery, do you know which end that the person's head is buried? It's not accidental. The casket is rested so that the head is in the west, pointed to the east. Do you know that whether a person is a Christian or not, when they put a casket in the ground, they are declaring the Christian hope that Christ is coming and he's returning from the east? And I'm telling you, he is coming back. Amen. I know he's coming back. Well, Pastor, what if you live your entire life and he doesn't return in your lifetime? You've wasted your life. What? I want to live every day prepared to meet him because I know this. I'm going to meet him. I'm going to meet him in my death, if that's first. And if I'm alive when he returns, hallelujah, praise God, I'll be changed and I'll meet him there. Child of God, do you even think about this? Jesus is coming back. Does it ever occur to you throughout the day? Well, if it hasn't this week, I'd encourage you. Wouldn't take you long. Read the book of Thessalonians, 5 chapters. Wouldn't take you long to read through it. And see this hope that we have as the people of God. Pray with me, please. Father, thank you for your word. Thank you for the hope we have in Christ. Not just in eternity, but the hope we have right now. May we live each day ready, prepared to meet you, Jesus. Thank you for what you're doing. In your name, amen. Would you stand? We want to sing together. I invite you to give your heart to Jesus. Renew your commitment. If you need to make a public decision, I'll meet you here at the front. Amen. I hope you see the work in your life, the work of God, because that's proof, that's evidence of what he's doing. Brandon, if you'll come at this time, just if this is your first Sunday back with us and you're a mother and didn't get your Mother's Day gift from us back here at the sound booth, Jeff has some pens that is your gift. Please pick that up before you leave. And just continue to reach out to people during this time. Stay connected. Thank you for being in worship this morning. All right. Brandon, would you lead us in a prayer?
God, we just come to you this morning and just thankful for that you are the one true and living God, and that you gave your son to die on the cross for us so that we could have a future home with you in heaven, just as so long as we repent and believe that Jesus did die for us and was buried and raised from the dead and sits at the right hand of you. And God, I just pray that, you know, as there's so many out there that aren't believers, that you start to pull on them to help them to seek that truth, and that as there are many believers out there that they start to become disciples, you know, people that are really seeking you and seeking to grow towards your will, and you know, being those that are doing so that others will see just the light through you. So God, I just ask you to help us as we go out throughout this week, and look for others to help, and just to share the good news of the gospel with everyone we see. All these things in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.